Hello. Good afternoon. The title of my talk for you today is Why Kids Can Be Really Good Hackers. Today I'm going to start my talk by introducing myself. Who am I? I am Reuben Abishai Paul, but my friends call me Rapstar. My Twitter handle is @PrudentGames. You can tweet about this talk if you like it. When I was 2 years old, I was recognized as America's most beautiful baby. When I was 7 years old, I was honored to receive the title of being the youngest Shaolin Kung Fu Black Belt in America. Today I am 8 years old and founder and CEO of Prudent Games Inc. We make entertaining games so that our customers learn while they play. Some of the games I have written are Cracker Proof, a fun way to learn about strong passwords. Crack Me If You Can, a fun way to learn about brute force attacks. And Shuriken Math, the game where ninjas teach you math. Some of these games are in the App Store and some are coming soon. Please check these games out. When I grow up, I want to be a cyber spy. It all began when my first grade teacher asked me, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" And this is what I drew. This is me laying back on the couch. This is my SQL injection hack going through the cloud. This is the other computer's firewall with holes in it. And this is the other computer pwned. Now let's start with why kids can be really good hackers, like me. Kids and hackers share similar qualities, and here are four of those qualities that I would like to expand on. First, they are both creative. Second, curious. Third, credible, at least the good ones are. And fourth, cool. First, just like hackers are creative, so are kids. How do I know that? One of the most successful kid companies that appeals and satisfies the creative mind of kids is Michael Farnham. Any guess?
Sorry, I was tweeting about you. Ask the question again.
One of the most successful kid companies that appeals and satisfies the creative mind of kids is
Rudy Gang.
Lego. So everybody, sing along with me. Everything is awesome. What? I can't hear you. Everything is awesome. Everything is cool when you're part of the team. HouSecCon is awesome. HouSecCon is cool when you're part of the team. Hey, I thought I was a bad singer. Now hearing you all sing, that gives me a little bit of hope. This picture is from my dad's book, and it shows how an adult would explain about hashing. Is this creative? In fact, I think it is. Boring. This is how a kid would explain hashing. First, there's the strawberries, which is the input. It is passed through a blender, which is the algorithm. After it is blended, it becomes a smoothie, which is the hash. But from the smoothie, you can never get the original strawberries back. Now, if you want your smoothie to be a little bit unique, just add a little salt to it. Cooking tip, don't do this in real life. Now, this is very creative and fun. Second, just like hackers are curious, kids are too. Hackers like to find out new stuff, and kids like to too. Here's a picture of Curious George saying, whose title could be, "Show me the monkey." And here's a picture of a hacker whose title could be, "Show me the money." The word credible means trustworthy. Kids are very credible, meaning that they could be very good at social engineering. In fact, I think that kids are the best social engineers. After my debut talk at DerbyCon, Chris Heinege, aka the human hacker, gave me an SE challenge coin. But my little brother Isai wanted one too. At first he did not get it, but as you can see in this picture, my little brother Itai has his own SE challenge coin. You want to know how he did it, how he social engineered the human hacker? Here's a step-by-step guide to learn how. First, get your target on their knees. Second, sweet talk them into giving you the SE challenge coin. Third, reach out for the SE challenge coin, but be cool about it. Fourth, take the FC challenge coin and allow a little pat on the head. Fifth, pose with the target for a good picture. Oh, and sixth, I think we forgot to add this step, but run away with the FC challenge coin before the target changes their mind. Now, cool. One of the primary motivators for hackers is ego. To prove to others that you are cool. Both hackers and kids like to prove to others that they can do things that others cannot. What? How many, for example, how many of you have seen the movie Finding Nemo? Why did Nemo get in trouble in the first place? Because he wanted to prove that he was cool and he went to go touch the butt. Ego plus exploitation equals ego-sploitation, a word that me and my dad made up, which is cool if you use it for the right reasons. Now let me show you how a kid can be a good hacker. I already explained to you that a kid can be a creative using the smoothie hash example, so I'll show you the curious quality using Nmap, the credible quality using Social Engineering Toolkit, and the cool quality using Beef. So as you can see here, I got three virtual machines open. One is Kali, one is Windows 8, and one is OS BWA. So a hacker would be curious to find out all the boxes that are up and running. He would use a tool like Nmap. But how do we know what range to scan in? Let's check our IP address. Our IP address is 192.168.56.101. So we're going to scan the subnet in that range. So it starts on Nmap and it's starting to scan. May take a little while. Should come up with three, yeah, here. Okay, so it came up with three boxes. This one, and this one. Our most interesting one is the OFBWA. Its IP address is 192.168.56.103. It also has a lot of ports open, like Secure Shell, which we could try Hydra brute force attacks, HTTP, for cross-site scripting, and which you could try for cross-site scripting and SQL injection, and so many more. Now my second demo is going to be on the credible side. We're going to do a credential harvester attack. We're going to clone a fake site. We need our IP address. So that the user machine will connect back to the attack machine. Our URL that we're going to clone today is going to be facebook.com. It's going to clone the website. So it says, do you want to start this process? Yes, we want to start this process. So all the files will be copied to the website directory. So let's pretend that we sent an email to this box saying, hey, go check out this link. But today, for time purposes, we're not going to send an email. We're just going to assume that they clicked on the link. So then a screen like Facebook pops up, but it really is just a fake website. So let's say the email is alice@facebook.com. Our password is, you'll see in a second. So we logged in. So it actually redirects you to the real Facebook site. But really what happened on the attacker machine is it comes back into the website directory. So let's see what's in the website directory. See, we have a harvester. We have a harvester file. We're going to open that up with cat. And it comes back saying the email is alice@facebook.com and the password is Alice in Blenderland. Now my next demo I'm going to do is going to be another social engineering toolkit attack. It's going to be a Java applet attack. What a Java applet attack does is it clones a fake site and then adds an applet on top of that. So the applet will be, when someone clicks the run button for the applet, a reverse TCP metaprotocol shell, so a shell would connect back from the attacker machine to the user machine. So then we can do stuff with that. So we don't need NAT port forwarding because we're not going over the internet. We're just doing it over here. Our IP address is going to be 192.168.56.101. We're going to make our own self-signed applet. What's our first and last name? Facebook. What's the name of your organizational unit? It's going to be IT. What's the name of your organization? IT. What's the name of your city or location? Cambridge. We actually researched this up. The Facebook facility is in Cambridge and it's in Massachusetts. Yes, this is right. Okay. So our URL that we're going to clone is obviously going to be Facebook. So we clone the website, it's injecting the Java applet into the newly cloned website. Then it comes back saying we're going to use a reverse TCP metaprotocol shell. We're going to encode it with Chicago.NA. What a Chicago.NA does is it encodes the payload, so it looks like a regular payload, but it really is the bad thing. So most of the times it'll avoid antivirus detection. Our port listener is going to be the default 443. And then it might take a little bit to start the payload up. But generally, we will also send an email for this. We will generally send an email to the user machine saying with the link. But today, for time purposes, we're not going to do that. See, it encodes the payload 4 times. And then it's starting up the Metasploit framework. This might take a little bit. So how many of you think this is cool? It's starting up. Up. Hey guys, what's your password? Anybody wants to volunteer to give their password? Nobody? Nobody? Yeah. There. So it started the payload handler. So we sent the email to the user machine, and then we come, and then it pops up as Facebook again since we cloned Facebook. But as you can see, there should be a little pop-up saying security warning. So just to show you, our subject is Facebook, IT, Cambridge, Massachusetts, and US. But what do most people do when they see an applet? Yes, click the run button. Done. So it's already sending the stage. The MitroPredator session one is open. So that's one shell. There, and then there's four more. And there's session two, session three, session four, session five. So we're going to start the interaction with session one. Starting the interaction. So now we're going to see type in help. So it can do, we can do a key scan, a webcam, we can hash dump it. At this point it's game over, but I have another demo to do, so I'm going to do that. Now this is the cool demo using Beef. So we're going to start up Beef. It's for a browser exploit framework. We're going to do cross-site scripting. So it has Beef in it. So now let's start up Beef, Ruby. So now we're starting up Beef on the command line because when you start up Beef on the command line, it gives you a hook link. So when we go try to do test if the applet, so when we go try to test if the applet, if the application is vulnerable to cross-site scripting, we should take this along because if it is, then we can put this in, and this will actually redirect. This will actually give a hook link onto B. So from that command line, you can do anything. So we're gonna copy this. Then we're going to go to a application, and that application, we actually got a startup beef on the Mozilla. The username is beef, and the password is beef. I'm gonna log in, and then it starts up. And then now we're going to go to an application, and that application is called the Damn Vulnerable Web Application. So go, find the Damn Vulnerable Web Application. The username is admin, password is admin, login, the setup. We're actually going to go to the cross-site scripting. Now, let's see if this website is vulnerable to cross-site scripting. So we type on our name, which is Bob. Then we're gonna see script. We're gonna try to cross-site script it. I mean, if it's cross-site scriptable. So then alert, and what we're going to say is and then we close the script. Then we sign the guest book. Then there's pop-up saying, you are all awesome, which means that's scriptable. Now we're gonna clear the database because we're gonna put the hook link in. So let's go to the hook link. Then we paste that. Oh, it's not letting me type. Because there is a restriction for how many number of characters you can go. So we use Mozilla web developer to remove maximum length, and then you can start typing again. Sneaky, huh? So basically nothing happened, but on the B control panel, on the online browsers, our box popped up because we pressed the sign yes button. Now let's see what will happen if we go on the user machine to that website. Say we really like the damn vulnerable web application. So we go there. So we want to sign the guest book. So we go and sign the guest book. But even before you even type anything, in a little bit, it should this the user machine IP address should pop up on here. So any second now. Take a little bit, but oh, and this box is the OSBWA, so it's running the application on that. And then this another box popped up, so just to show you, it becomes a zombie. And then at this point, it's game over again because we can control that browser. So even if they close the browser, it's still hooked onto B. So let's say we go back to Internet Explorer, because we need that open for this attack. And go to the damn vulnerable web application. 103. So, now, we're going to cross encrypting store. So then we can do a number of attacks. You can go to the browser to check if the Microsoft Office is open. We can debug it. We can do a lot of social engineering attacks. But we are going to do a social engineering attack. We're going to make a fake notification bar. Yeah. Data. There. So, okay. So let's say for your safety. When it's not really safe. Your session has timed out. Please log back in. And then before we send that, we're going to do a little thing called a pretty theft. It's going to act like it's Facebook. So then we're going to actually go to the IE. And then actually, so here. Okay, no, I'll type that in again. Then let's execute that, and then immediately after that, let's go to the pretty theft and then execute that. And then up here, they're just typing that we like this website. Then a notification bar should come up. Lesson's on. Oh. So we're just going to use this default text. Let's pretend that that said your session has timed out. So then we're going to make notification that. Execute that. Then pretty stuff. Execute that. Up here it should come. Same. The website wants to run the following. Really, it should say, since we couldn't do that, for your safety, your session has timed out. Please log back in. And then it actually looks like your session has timed out. So most people just log back in because they want to type their stuff. And log in. But back on the pretty theft, it comes back saying Alice@gmail.com and the password is Alice in Wonderland. So those are the demos I wanted to show you. And now go back to Keynote. I want to thank my God Jesus Christ for the gifts he has given me. I want to thank the organizers of this conference, the awesome Lego team, Michael Farnham, Sam Van Ryder, and David Nestner for trusting me and giving me this opportunity. I want to thank my school, Harmony School of Science, and my family for supporting me in everything I do. And I want to thank you all for coming here and speak. You have just heard why kids can be really good hackers, probably for the first time. And the Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, they will not depart from it. In like manner, train up a child in InfoSec to be white hat hackers, and when they are old, they will know how to defend themselves. Here's my contact information, Reuben@prudentgames.com. Please contact me Please contact me if you want to invite me to your next talk. I can even do keynotes, and I'm not talking about the Apple product. Any questions?